Hi, good afternoon, everyone. To those who have stayed in the room after the next talk, thank you. And those who are coming in, welcome to the automation track. We have Andreas from Class E Systems talking about Qt Wayland.
Okay, thank you for the introduction and the interest for this talk. Probably there are not that many people around in the world who want to write a compositor or use it or have the need of getting one. Since you make it runtime and it's running and it's nice. What I want to do in this talk is explaining a little bit when you have the need for creating your own compositor, why it's important, how it can make your life a little bit better, and go a little bit deeper into how to do it. And then, I think in 1 hour later about, Johan Helsing will have another talk who will get really deep into how to do it and directly showed by live coding how you create your own compositor in one talk. Okay, let me introduce a little bit about the field I'm coming from and about myself. I'm coming from Class E System. We are in the agriculture sector for really big machines, especially combine harvesters, big tractors, these big light green machines. For us, we have machines that are typically much more complicated than a car. There are a lot of ECUs that are connected by a really big network, so not 10, but many more ECUs. Robustness is extremely important for us, since you buy a combine harvester for, let's say, $500,000, and you have only a few weeks in a year where it must run, and every minute of downtime, it costs you money. It's not your car that's sitting in your garage. It's a machine that you want to use. We have safety requirements. The machines are not only running on fields; they are running on public streets. So there are certain requirements we have to apply to. UI. If you have a customer who is used to tablets and cell phones and smartphones and all the nice handy stuff and then sitting in a big machine and the screen looks similar to a tablet, he expects exactly the same comfort how to use it, even if it controls a 16-ton machine below him that is actually a factory that you are running over a field. I'm Andreas. I'm working at E-Systems. I'm working there since 1.5 years. Previously, I've been at university in the theoretical computer science. I'm also from the KDE world. And well, if you want to know anything more about us and we're hiring, just ask me. A little bit more about the field I'm talking about. At the right, I put a picture of our current terminal. It's not Qt-based, if you ask. But something like that we are putting on our machines. And if we are looking at current requirements and future requirements, we are coming to a point where it's not possible anymore to put everything in a single process. Especially since we are in automotive, we often have suppliers who provide applications, and it's easier to integrate applications together with a compositing framework and not in one process. Also for robustness, it's really much easier to separate the processes. We have to bring a modern look and feel on our devices, so you cannot put only the windows of the different applications next to each other. That's too boring. And safety regulations, which I don't want to touch today since it's today's talk, probably. For our system architecture, or how do we have to put the software onto the devices? That means we are in a multi-application scenario, and hence also in a multi-window scenario. So we have different windows from different applications that we have to combine somehow on the screen. Your UI department might come with unexpected ideas how the user experience could be improved. No idea what. It could be flying windows coming in, shrinking, nice shader effects. And they want to see something like that and directly see how could it look to a customer. So rapid prototyping is also a need there. And then you have a hardware that is typically not really recent. Since, well, if you have an embedded device that has to provide 4 CAN ports, you have to develop it by yourself or by a supplier, and that takes, let's say, 2 or 3 years, and then the hardware isn't that new. So no new GPU, CPU is a little bit slow, and you have to cope with it. However, I won't talk anymore about agriculture here, since it's always not so simple to talk about something that's not on the market yet, that's not published already. So I will talk about my kitchen. And let's assume I want to have a terminal in my kitchen to control the kitchen a little bit and help me there. So that's much easier and not so disturbing for my boss to talk about. Okay, for my kitchen application, I want to have different applications running there. Let's say a clock, a timer for cooking eggs, a timer for cooking tea, maybe also showing my recipes. Then all these applications that provide windows should be combined in some nice UI, so some seamless UI where you have them all organized each together. Maybe you also, well, I also want to have swipe gestures. Let's say not only one finger, but 2 finger swipe gestures. And that's already interesting, since I have 2 fingers. So one finger could be on the left app, second finger at the right app. So you cannot put the swiping into the applications. It must be in the compositor. I want to have navigations with, well, say, previews of the applications running. Well, where are these blue bubbles? And then everything should run on a, well, let's say IMX6 or even older embedded device. At least we know there is a GPU, so we can use Qt Quick. And now the question, well, how to do that? For sure, we need a compositor, since the windows have to compose together. And I bet there is no standard compositor that you can directly use and that works out of the box. So the question is, how do we get to such a compositor? And I think that's a typical scenario, where you have ideas from your UI department, where you have to combine different applications, and in a nice user experience, and you have to want to prototype it or even develop it. For example, if you go upstairs from our competitors, you see there's a device where you can see exactly the same idea. Okay, window compositing on embedded devices is relevant today. I don't know anybody who is using X anymore. Wayland itself is a protocol that explains or that defines how a client is speaking to the compositing server. So you have, let's say, my tea cooking timer application, and that speaks via the Wayland protocol with my compositing server and tells, well, I'm here, I have a window, could you show it somewhere? And the compositor gets this information and displays it. And that's only a standardized way how to really talk to each other with an application and with a compositor. Already there are existing compositors. For example, if you look in at the desktop world, for KDE Plasma we have Qwin, we have for the GNOME world we have Matter, for Enlightenment there's also something else. So there are already existing compositors, however, they don't really fit to our use case. Also, there's Weston, which is the reference implementation of the Wayland protocol, especially to test the protocol and show how it should be used. And I know about different forks of it, proprietary forks who use it to do something like providing their own compositor. The Wayland protocol itself is really lean. And if you want to add new functionality, you can add protocol extensions. For example, for a desktop, if you want to make screenshots over the whole screen, you have to do it via the compositor, since only the compositor knows the whole screen. So for that, for example, in the KDE world, we have a Wayland extension that communicates with the compositor, tells, well, could you create a screenshot, and then the screenshots are sent back to a public place. There's some boilerplate code that's automatically generated with this Wayland scanner. application. The valent, well, the default dialect, how the client is talking to the compositor, that the rough meaning you can say that's the WL shell or it's the XDG shell. It's the interface, how windows are provided to the compositor, how the surface are annotated, which informations are provided. For example, if you have a surface provided via the WL shell, you get the title of the window and the name of the application. For the XDG shell, which is specifically designed for desktop environments, you get much more information. For the automotive context, there's the Ivy shell, which provides essentially a standardized way to combine applications together on a in-vehicle infotainment system. The concept there is that you not only have a compositor, but also a controlling application. So the what's called the Ivy window manager, who controls the compositor and tells the compositor what to do. However, from my experience, that's only really usable if you don't have too many windows and surfaces and not too many dynamics there. I did proof of concepts with that and I found limits. What I want to talk about in this talk is the Qt-Valent compositor framework. It's not the internals are not new, and that's always important. It's always major technology. It's there since a lot of years. With Qt 5.7, there was a tech preview for the for new API how to use it, and with Qt 5.8, it's now stable. What this framework now provides you is an easy way to create a compositor in just QML. So you have a declarative language to explain how you want your windows displayed on the screen. So any surface is wrapped into a Qt Quick item. Internally, it's something else, but it's a Qt Quick item. And you can use it like a typical element in a, on a Qt Quick scene. So just imagine that the window that you want to put somewhere on the screen is a rectangle. And you can do the same transformations and operations to it, like anchoring, like applying shader effects, like clipping some things out. Everything like that works. It's simply feeling like an item. That's, in my opinion, the real power of this framework. Since you can now, you don't have to think about how this all the complicated compositor stuff works. If you look in the Western code, it's really not that self-explaining how to modify it. Here, just there are just Qt Quick items. You put it together and you do it in the typical way. There are also different shells that are supported. I only used a WL shell for now. That always worked for me, and then added custom protocol extensions for more information I wanted to send to the compositor. So let's think about my kitchen application. How would a typical, or how would an architecture look like? We are already we are lucky, we already have a Qt platform extraction for our Valent. So any Qt application you create, it already can run as a Valent client. So you only have to pass this minus platform Valent or set the environment variable for that. So on the client side, we are ready. Then the compositor side, you can create this Qt Valent compositor, which I will show you on the next slide, and it's only one slide for the whole compositor. And what is possibly also a nice idea, it's additional shell application, similar to what the Ivy people are doing. That can be a good idea for two reasons. One reason is if you want to have a custom protocol extension. In that case, every client must know this protocol extension, must somehow link to Valent specific libraries. Sometimes it's easier if you want to have a customer who provides an application to you that you want to embed later into your device, that you encapsulate all this logic and also prevent this supplier from doing some weird stuff with the Valent compositor. So you have an, well, managing component in between that filters all the operations the application wants to do and does the right thing, the things that you want to do. Second reason might be robustness. So you have a different process that has all the complicated business logic and one process for the compositing. Both are fine, I think. I know that both exist. It's always, well, you have to decide what you like better. For this talk, for the next slides, the example I will show you, I will stick to the left. Okay, and that's a compositor for the, it's not complete for that what I wanted to have. I don't have the preview here. I have only the surface, well, any application that I can now start with the Valent platform is automatically registered. It's in a long ribbon that I can swipe only with one finger, that since I'm putting everything in a cute quick list view that only provides swiping with one finger. You have to add your own input handler for that. But essentially, it's already working. So what do I see here? I have a Valent compositor. It has an output. That's a window. And I put a rectangle in it. And this rectangle has a list view. And now the magic is this list view has a model that I'm filling here. And that's a handler to the WL shell. And every time I get a new surface created, since I'm using the minus platform Valent, if I start an application, it's registered via the WL shell. It's created here. I put it into my list. So I have a list of surfaces, or cute quick surfaces. And that I simply show in my list view. And I'm done. So that's a really simple example how you can do it. I could actually also take the surfaces and put it into an additional list, since I can create a new cute quick surface and use the same shell surface for it to creating it. So I have two items using the same buffer and at different points. So you can have actually live previews if I put it into an additional list on the bottom where I have my navigation bar. Looking a little bit more deeper into it, well, usually in such an application you always have one compositor. Everything else would be weird and I have no idea if it would crash at the beginning. That's typically usually the root object. You have to provide an output, so you have to tell the compositor where the output should be. You can add different several outputs if you have different several screens, for example. You have to connect it somehow to the shell. I'm using here the WL shell, and simply the on WL shell surface created handler. And when that surface is created, I put it into my list. What is important here, or what I figured out is important, if you want to distinguish windows from different applications, not all information are already at this point, since it's an asynchronic mechanism how the client is talking to the compositor. For example, the title and the class name of the window are not there. So you don't know at the beginning already from which application is the surface coming. So you have to add some logic later on if you want to handle specific surfaces or specific applications differently. For example, that you have one application always at the left, then you have to buffer them somewhere and put them later on the list, or reorder it when you have this information. Now we have these shell surfaces. There's my delegate that I use for creating my, well, for filling my list. Well, it's a cute quick item. It's a derived from cute quick item. You can handle it exactly the same way. It has a fixed size now. You can also modify it. And I'm only removing it when it's destroyed. It's really simple here. And it's really a nice thin wrapper around the surface you want to put somewhere on the screen. Short example how a shell extension could look like. I don't want to show any generated code, since that is only one directional call I have here. We distinguish between two kinds of messages that are sent. A request is sent from the client to the server, so from the Wayland client to the Wayland compositor, and you have events that are sent back from the compositor to the client. So,
what's the name of the second thing? Event.
So request and event. That you can put into your Qt Wayland scanner, and that's already generating a Qt styled API that you can use in the application. And then it depends on do you want to put it only in the client, in the shell application that is somehow the manager between your clients and the compositor, or do you want to put it into all the clients that you don't have a manager between, and then you have to add into every application a little bit of boilerplate code. And that's the reason why a shell application might make sense here. However, then you would need a different IPC mechanism that you might already have in place. But that's, for example, how it could look like. It's simply a specification how the protocol works. You can also add enums there and much more complicated stuff. However, I don't want to show it. And actually, I want to leave all the live coding and demoing stuff to Johan. I did a similar talk some months ago, or long time ago. It's the starting of this year. There you can find all the code, the demo code for this example, where you can have the swiping and not the previewing yet, only some bubbles. But that's the code that simply creates this compositor that has this custom extension, shows notifications there, and that's it. And to come to my end, I think the main power of this framework is that it makes so easy to create a compositor, and that it makes it that easy for non-Wayland experts. So you can make prototyping. This example I created here, it was an evening. For my first trial for creating a much more complex compositor, it was a two-day ride to get it working. But that's not that much time. If I would have started with Weston, I bet it would have been a month. And you can stop here thinking about what all the compositing logic is doing behind. At the end, when you want to improve your performance, then you have to think again about it. But in your design phase, and when you want to create a really nice user experience and combine everything together and show your designers how it could feel on an embedded device, that you have a compositor where you can swipe and have pinch effects and so on, then it's really fast. And also from measurements I know, it's not really slower than what you can do with Weston and other different approaches. However, if you don't want to do it in QML, there's also the C++ API, which is, in my opinion, much harder to use. Since with QtQuick, we have a declarative way to explain what you want to have, and that's the absolutely right thing for creating a nice user experience. And I would tell you, go to Johan's talk, see how it works, and try it yourself. It's really extremely simple. Okay, thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Andrea.
Good talk.